Okay, everybody, let's get started. This is a recording of this morning's seminar that we screwed up the audio somehow, so we are doing this without audience this time, and we are talking about the EU privacy laws and startups this afternoon. So first, a few words about Exove. We are a digital design and development company. We have offices in Helsinki, Tampere and Oulu in Finland, in Tallinn, Estonia and London in UK. We are a full service portfolio company that starts from an idea and ends with the care or something in between. Both multinational giants, the biggest companies in Finland are our clients, and also we have a number of startups, so we know what we are talking today. We do have also a sweat equity company called Exo Ventures, and we are a company that delivers digital growth. If you want to know more about us, then exo.com/GDPR for the GDPR stuff, and then at Exo at Twitter, you can find more information there. About myself, I'm the CEO and founder of the company. Before joining or founding Exove, I worked for Continuent, First Hop, SH when it was still in startup mode, and then Helsinki University of Technology. Coding from 83 with week 20, and started with web on 94, so quite early on. I've been doing a number of startup cases in Exove, Golf Gamebook, Scoopshot, Easy Break, Blick, Jaiku, and so forth. More about me, kallio.la or LinkedIn. You can follow me there and then at Plastic in Twitter. Agenda today is that we'll go through the new privacy directive or privacy regulation. In a nutshell, we go through the background, we go through the new rights for the individuals, and then new requirements for the companies, and then what to do on the practical approach. And then we had questions and answers, but no, because there's no audience now, there won't be that many questions or answers. I'll try to incorporate the questions that were asked in the morning in the presentation. So, general data protection regulation is the new EU's privacy regulation that harmonizes the different privacy regulations in different member states, and it gives new rights to the individuals. It will replace, or it has replaced, the old directive from 95 that is outdated and implemented differently in member states. In a nutshell, it's a regulation, so it means that unlike directive, it's full in force when it's accepted, so it doesn't need to be put in a local legislation. The local legislation itself needs to be compatible with the regulation, and there are changes in the member states to change the local regulation or legislation, and then the regulation has a number of points where there are possibilities to adjust details on country level. It adds rights to individuals, and it adds requirements or responsibilities to companies. It doesn't add any responsibility for the individuals, and it doesn't add any rights to the company. So in that sense, it's very, very strict regulation. It applies to all companies worldwide. That is changed from the EU's current way of thinking, that all the companies worldwide, even outside EU, are under the regulation if they process at least one EU member state in individual's data. GDPR is in force already, and the transition period is ongoing, and it will end in around 11 months on 25th of May in 2018. And the administrative sanctions can be considerable, so if you don't follow the regulation but are blatantly uncompliant, you can be fined up to 4% of the global turnover or 20 million euros. Which one is higher? And this is the way EU got the companies listening, and this was also the way I got the audience in the morning listening to me. So I guess that you, dear friends of the video, you hopefully pay attention to this also, that this is crucial, that the EU is serious about this. There are two data handling roles in the regulation. the company that collects the data and sort of is responsible for data, builds the business around the use of data, that's called controller. It's responsible for and needs to be able to demonstrate compliance with the regulation, including also the work done by the processor. And the processor is a subcontractor of controller that processes personal data on behalf of the controller. Processor must be written, with written contract, it must be bound to the controller and follow written orders and written orders only. So if you deal with a company that hosts your site or service, does some analytics for you or something like that, you need to have a written contract with them, and the contract needs to stipulate what kind of actions this company is doing to the data that you as a controller hold or give them. And the processor must return or delete all the data when the contract ends. GDPR defines personal data on very, very broad level. The definition is that any information concerning an identified or identifiable, this is a big thing, natural person, such as name, my name is Janne Kalliola, I'm recognized by that, my phone number, my email address, my car license plate, or even my dynamic IP address. All of those are considered personal data. So the access log of your Nginx, Apache, Node.js system is a collection of personal data, and if somebody sees that, then that person is processing personal data, and you need to have according rules to make it with the compliance with the regulation. If you pseudonymize data, then that will be also personal data if it can be reverted easily with some additional data that's available. There are certain areas of data that are more sensitive than the others, and they need to be handled with special care. Typically, political affiliation, union memberships, health, anything to do with health, genetic and biometric data, and so forth. And also, children are identified as vulnerable individuals that require specific protection, and the consent to process children's data must be given by the person that has the parental responsibility. Children is in regulation a person that is less than 16 years old. It might be in some countries even 13 years old, but it depends on the country. So better play safe and go with the highest possible. Other major concepts in the regulation are that you need to be transparent and you need to have consent from the individuals. So you need to tell, and the individuals need to know, how and why their data is used, what is the purpose, what is the duration, what are the end results, and so forth. And you need to give a valid reason to process the data. For example, that there's a contract that requires you to do it. There are a number of different valid reasons, contractual, that you as a company and the individual have a contract that to be ordered to be fulfilled, that contract, the company, you need to manage some personal data of a person, meaning that, for example, your system uses email addresses as accounts and then can send from time to time some information. That's okay, and you have contract. Then there are legal reasons. For example, if you are invoicing people, then the people that are whose name is on the bill, they can't just say that, okay, forget me forever, but you need to keep the invoices stored for 6 years in Finland, 6 plus 1 year, the current year and the 6 preceding years in the part of the books that are there on it and so forth. And nobody can ask you to remove them. But then later, if you store older receipts, then if they ask to be removed, then you need to remove them. And then the consent. Consent is that somebody agrees that okay, my data can be processed as said. If somebody gives a consent, then that person can take the consent away almost immediately or anytime. And then you need to act according to that. If I remove my consent, then you need to actually stop processing my data and probably also delete it. Privacy by design default. This is big thing for all the architects in the audience. That the system needs to be designed to take privacy into account from the very beginning. This is a good example. Is the payment card industry PCI standards that define number of things how things are done. So you need to start to think the private data, data under privacy as a payment card or credit card numbers, and then you are on the right mindset that you feel that the data is somehow sacred or holy, and you need to have a right kind of approach to it, and you need to respect the data and so forth. And then that's probably what EU wants. Accountability. This changes from the current situation. Now that the IT privacy offices in countries need to prove that you are doing something wrong before they can give any sanctions, and the sanctions are typically slapping on the wrist, and that's maybe 200 euros and that's it. But now you as a company need to be able to prove that you are following the regulation, so it's reversed. So you need to have a process documentation, paper trails of decisions, maybe privacy impact assessments if your business is completely or mostly based on using private data or there are the sensitive data and so forth. And this is something that is not well handled in startups. When I asked the question with the startup audience here that who has paper trails, nobody raised their hand. That just doesn't happen, but you need to start happening in the future. The rights of the individuals will grow. There is more rights and there are extended rights. So access to data, this is all that you, the individual must be able to see the data collected about them. So you need to be able to provide the data. If I request my data from you, then you have 1 month. In general, there are some extensions, but in general you have 1 month to reply to me in commonly used electronic format, free of charge for the first time, and then later you can charge something. I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know what are the exact sums, but probably something that covers your cost. So I can't start spamming you with every second that give my data, because that would be burden for you. If the data that I see in your systems is wrong, then I can ask you to rectify, meaning fixing it. So if my name is spelled wrong, you need to fix it and so forth. Then there's right of erasure. I can ask that, okay, remove all my data. Again, all that data needs to be removed that there is no other reason to keep it. For example, if I have a contract with you that I don't terminate, and the contract requires me to provide or you to keep some data about me to be able to serve me, then you can use that data, but all the other data needs to go. Also with legal, that I can't tell that remove my data from your invoices, and then the old invoices that have been sent need to be there as part of the bookkeeping archive until 6 years or what is the legislation in the country. Object of processing, I can ask you to stop specific kind of processing. There are several different ways to process, but the direct marketing is the one that is mentioned especially, and this is the only one that I can ask you to stop processing without any reason. I can say, okay, stop direct marketing, and that's it. You can't then do direct marketing towards me anymore. The other thing is the portability, that I have right to ask my data to be given to me, and then I could then input into some other system. This caused some discussion with the audience, that the point is that if somebody has a way to input somebody else's data, for example, let's say the video watching history of my Netflix, and then the with the all the movies that they have, and what I have seen, what I've liked, and so forth. I could then export it from Netflix with the access to data, and then with portability, with let's say Amazon Prime, could input that data, and then use it. So this is something that should be doable in light of GDPR, but currently there are no interchangeable formats yet. They might appear, and then if your business is affected, you might end up in a situation that you need to comply with this one. But I see this very, very corner case that this is the last one to worry. Restricting processing, you might ask to stop the company to process your information for a period of time. The company might temporarily remove the content, but this is for example, if I have a court case against you, I can ask you to stop, or there's a big discrepancy that what I think should be the rectified version of my data, and you think that I'm lying to you. I could say, okay, restrict processing, let's figure this out first and then continue. Very complex on the IT architecture point of view. Profiling and automated decision taking. Profiling of person is accepted, it's allowed. But if it's based on sensitive content, then I need to give explicit consent. For example, if you profile me on my health records or political affiliation, then I need to give a special content to you, explicit consent about that. And then if there's automated decision taking, that the system profiles me and then makes decisions on my behalf automatically, and they have significant effects on me, legal or financial effects, reputation and so forth, I can ask you to intervene that automatic decision taking process with manual actions and sort of submit the decision that the computer made into manual inspection and maybe changes. But the effects needs to be significant, that it's not that if I lose 1 euro that you calculate different offers for me and I get 1 euro higher price than the other guy. That's not significant, but if it's like 1,000 euro, then it might be significant already. So, for example, when you sell trips, and then based on the profile, people get different prices, then it might be there. But again, if you have a hunch that this might affect you, then consult your lawyer. Data transfer outside European Economic Area, EEA, are restricted, but they are allowed. The transfer require adequate level of protection, so when you transfer data out, you need to make sure that the person or the body getting the data outside EEA is bound to you with this adequate level of protection that is sort of the same level as you are bound with GDPR. There are EU model clauses, there are a couple of other ways to do it. Certain countries are considered safe, like New Zealand, Liechtenstein, by the Commission, and they should provide that the legislation is compatible with GDPR, and they should provide a list of those countries. Safe harbor, it was dismantled after the Schrems case, and now it's replaced with Privacy Shield. That is also tested now in court, so it might come crumbling down, but that helps you to host your data in the US. It should be noted that this was some discussion up in the audience back in the morning, that it is enough that somebody has access to that data, even so that they have a password or some other mechanism to authenticate themselves and see the data, even if they ever use the password. So if, for example, you have an Indian subcontractor managing your host and they have the password for your databases, then they actually are possible to see the data, and then you need to make sure that they are considered as a processor and you are bound them legally. And you need to, as a controller, make sure that the chain of contracts goes until to the company that actually employs the person touching the data. So the chain of contracts must be full. Data breaches, if these things happen, then the processor that finds out that, okay, now there's a data breach that somebody has cracked in, needs to be, without undue delay, so it means right away, of course, checking out that this is real, that this is not a false alarm, and so forth, inform the controller without exceptions, that there are no rights to stay silent. And the controllers need to inform authorities within 72 hours when they become aware of the breach, either finding by themselves or that the processor tells them that their data has been breached and there's an issue with the data integrity or something. And in some cases, the controller needs to inform the data subjects, meaning the individuals, about the breach. 72 hours is interesting in that sense that for example, is the Christmas Eve is on Monday, then in Finland it means that there's 5 days of holidays, or weekend and 3 days of holidays, and somebody needs to be available during those times, and those are probably also the hot days for people to try to crack in, because there's less people watching the services and so forth, and also less people to react. So you need to be prepared, somebody needs to have responsibility, needs to stay sober enough to work on the situation if that happens. For the UX, this has a couple of implications. The consent is more regulated than it before, so it needs to be specific and needs to be unambiguous, and it can't be part of any other written contract. So it needs to be explicitly asked, and the user needs to know what he or she is providing the data for. It must be active, so you can't have pre-checked boxes, so if you have that, then do remove them. It must be reversible, so I can any given moment reverse or take away my consent. It must be recorded that I've given the consent, so better to have a database table or some document collection that says that, okay, Janne Kallio gave the consent on this day, on this page and for this thing and so forth. Otherwise, if you, for example, now are based on running the your some part of your data, personal data stuff, on consent, and you don't have this registry, then you have 11 months time to get the registry up and running and re-ask the consent, or otherwise you need to scrap all your data. This is a good time to act. And consent can't be required for a service that works without using personal data. So then you can't ask that, okay, would you like to give us some data that we don't actually need to run the service? And this is something that you take into account when you design the systems. Privacy policy is more important than before. You need to have storage time for the data and be more explicit what you do and so forth. Consult your lawyer to write a good excellent privacy policy. In the contracting, as mentioned, the contract needs to be with every single processor, and the responsibility goes to the end of the subcontracting chain. The controller needs to have guarantees from his processor that they have done their task and they have the similar contracts for their processor and so forth. Because in typical network world, there's a number of companies before there's the employer in certain cases. The contract has certain mandatory clauses that GDPR stipulates, and then all the actions that the processor does needs to be defined in writing. This typically means, and this is advice that I heard from a lawyer, that it would be a good idea to let the processor write the contract, because they actually know what they are doing with the data. They probably know it better than the controller. And if you are a processor in the role of processor, within your business, there was, for example, one company that analyzes sales data of other companies. So then the controller is their client and they are processor of the controller's data. Of course, they have their own data too of the use of the system, but that's other thing. So they actually know better than their clients what they are going to do with the data. So they should write the agreement, not the client. So that's GDPR in a nutshell, quite tight nutshell. There's more. There are exceptions. There are the local specialists and others. So going through that, you need a lawyer. I'm not a lawyer, as said, but this gives a good overall view that how things are. So what's now? My personal advice is this is real, that you need to get going, so better be prepared. You need to start now, even if you haven't already, because soon you are late. It feels 11 months is long time for a start, but actually time flies, and this is not on top of anybody's agenda. You want to hunt customers, you want to get more traction, you want to get more visibility, you are fighting with the venture capitalists and so forth, but you need to take also care of this, even if this doesn't bring anything except protection to you. And everything that you already do now should be under GDPR. So the data architecture, pay attention to it. Think of user rights and how they are implemented. If you, as an old company, you could get a leeway from the, that okay, we have a legacy system that has been coded in 60s or 70s and it's hard to change and so forth. So the officers would understand that it might not be point to change it. But if your system is written 2 weeks ago and you said, okay, yeah, it's still legacy, then probably everybody thinks that you're an idiot. So all the modern systems that you have should be GDPR compliant. Privacy by design. And that's the most important thing. And then understanding how the data flows and so forth. You need to train your people. Every single one in the organization need to be trained at what the data privacy means and what the GDPR means and how they should do in different situations. You need to have the process mapped and so forth, and then people trained that they can actually work according to the processes. I know that this feels really unstartupy, but there is no other way that do it. Then of course how light you can do it, then it's up to you. And then if you are unsure, get external help if you don't know how to proceed. This is crucial. If you don't know, don't guess. This is 80 pages of deep and thick legal document, this GDPR, so don't start reading it yourself, but get the help somewhere. In order to be compliant, you need to understand the GDPR and its effects to the organization. You must understand how the data flows in the systems, where, what, and why the data is stored, how it's processed, and so forth. You need to be aware that whether it flows outside EEA area or to other controller, and that you have notified your users about it, and then you have permission to do it. You need to have defined and followed is the crucial thing, procedure for handling personal data. Typically, I ask this, how many of the startups here, about 15 to 20 startups, how many of them had written, defined, followed procedures for personal data handling, and not a single hand rose up. So it was complete zero. You need to do this. It feels pointless, but it's for your own good. All the partners need to have a written contract with you. And you need to be moving now, and you need to be compliant on 25th. There's probably some leeway, but I would not count too much on it. Especially if you are a young company with a quite recent infrastructure, there's no point saying that, okay, this is because the IT is so slow and humans and others, and you can't really change it. You can say that we are a small company, we can't do everything from scratch immediately, but if you show that you are doing good progress and you're taking this seriously and you're doing what you can, then most probably you won't get fines or you will get only small fines. But if you do nothing, then you're asking for trouble. We as EXO, we have partnered with Bird and Bird to tackle the GDPR together from legal, processual, and technical perspective and simultaneously. We provide two-step process to go through this. So we have the gap analysis that we understand together with you that where you stand now and what is the gap towards the compliance. We do that with structured and tailored interviews, so taking into account your business, the industry, the situation there and so forth. And then we have workshop about the results, and then the gap analysis that tells that these are the major 10 things, for example, that you need to take into account. And then there's compliance program that is a complete undertaking to ensure that you are GDPR compliant. The gap analysis goes so that we send questionnaires. This is not a startup slide. You can see that ICT, human resources, legal and business, it might be exactly the same guy in the startup, the founder, that got all the questionnaires. Then we analyze the situation. Then we workshop together to go through the results, and then we provide an analysis that you get the report of what are the major findings and what is the action needed. And then optionally, there's an assessment with the client and offer for the compliance program. And in the compliance program, we plan and execute a complete compliance program to make sure that you are compliant with the GDPR, that you are safe. And based on the gap analysis findings, industry of client and the assessor's risks, we propose different kind of solutions, and then you can select based on the risk level of what you want to implement. Typically there are changes to processes, documentation, technology, user experience and contracts. Marketing maybe also added there. And the depth of the work is agreed case by case, that sometimes you want somebody to do it fully, you are well-funded startup and you said, okay, we'll spend on it and do it once and all. Or then you are on a shoestring budget and you won't just have consulting when you are unsure. Both models work for us. The gap analysis is for early stage companies, I would say from 8,000 to 16,000, depending on the complexity of the system, the countries involved and so forth. And then the compliance program is anything between 20,000 euros to 200,000 euros. The 200,000 euro is more established company with number of offices and so forth, so it is the top end. But I would, depending on your, especially if you have the need to do the special care data like the healthcare and the political affiliation and so forth, then it might be that it goes higher. But you should budget something like 25 to 50 or 75k to handle this whole thing. And it might sound a lot to you, but I can assure you that if you sleep better that after you have done this, then it's an investment that should be made, because the good night's sleep of the founder is one of the biggest factors for success in startups. That actually, if the people are well rested, they can focus, they get things done, and this is done and over, then you are way easier position than that you need to worry about this every single day. That's all I got. There was one question from the audience that this is good to discuss here before we end this session, and it was that there's a startup with B2B clients only, so it's B2B transactions, and if the company provides the startup, their client provides the startup personal information about the employees, is that information under GDPR? And the answer is yes. Every single thing, notwithstanding whether it's your employee, it's a business person per se, or it's a private person, all of those, when as long as they're natural persons, but machines or companies, they fall under GDPR. So how you deal with your staff, how you deal with in B2B situation, or how you deal with B2C situation, there is no difference. The individual have the rights and you as the company, you have just the restrictions and responsibilities. Okay, that's all that we had on the GDPR. Hopefully you enjoyed this recording, and if you want any help with the GDPR, then we are here at Itämerenkatu, or send us a mail to info@exo.com. My name is Lanna Kalliola. This was a pleasure.